Half-Life Alyx is one of the most groundbreaking and immersive games I have ever played, and has set a new incredibly high standard in VR game design. And in today's episode, we're going to be taking a look at the game design techniques that actually make this possible, and talk about the good, the great, and the questionable. So spoiler warning from this point onwards, guys, and welcome to the anatomy of Half-Life Alyx. Our story follows Alyx Vance on her journey across the desolate and oppressive streets of City 17 to investigate the disappearance of her father and unravel a combined conspiracy concerning the mysterious vessel ominously floating above the city's skylines and its insidious contents. One of the beauties of Half-Life Alyx is how incredibly easy it makes it to completely lose yourself within its world, and virtual reality games are known for being immersive experiences, and this word gets thrown around a lot by journalists, but what does immersion even mean? Well, our discussion begins with the physics of play. As designers, immersion can be broken down into many different categories. We covered a couple of these states in my episode on Katana Zero, so go and watch that episode for a deeper dive into these specific states, but the one that I'd like to focus on today is spatial immersion. Spatial immersion is the state of being enveloped and immersed in a believable space or environment, and this is intrinsic to virtual reality as it places you in the environment, mimicking the experiences you'd feel if you were there. And the one Alyx does especially well are scale, lighting, and physics. To start with scale, the size of objects isn't a super impactful thing on a 2D screen, but in VR, the scale of objects can be awe-inspiring. And when this is done right, not only can it increase the believability or verisimilar quality of the world, but on the extreme side, it can induce a sense of dread or panic as these buildings and creatures tower over you. And in order to make these unrealistically large and alien things feel real, the game requires an amount of consistency in its internal logic. For example, the gravity gloves are not realistic in our world, but they make sense within the games, where technology like this is everywhere. And another aspect adding to the believability and realism of these gravity gloves is the game's physics. Summoning items towards you with the gloves just feels natural, and acts as it should if these gloves actually exist. This is consistent for the rest of the game. Physics work as expected and have weight to them. And yes, you can't physically feel weight through your controllers, but Alyx manages to make larger objects feel heavy by limiting player movement and requiring multiple hands to actually lift these larger objects. And this replication and realism is emulated throughout the game in its nearly infinite interactable items and physics-based puzzles designed to enhance the verisimilar quality of this play space. And the same fidelity and attention to detail has been paid to the lighting of the world, playing off of objects reflecting and reacting realistically. And when all of these systems work harmoniously, it is the single greatest contributor to spatial immersion, but it doesn't always go as planned. When aiming to make a game so hyper-realistic in its systems, you're going to encounter some problems. There's this expectation for developers to make every single detail realistically interactable, which puts a big strain on development resources. But this is absolutely essential, because messing up any one of these aspects can break spatial immersion instantly. So Alyx has taken great care in making sure that the interactions between the player and the world make sense, including its UI design. So as a sound designer, I talk about diegesis a lot and its relationship with game mechanics, not just sound. When something is considered diegetic, it originates from inside the game's world itself rather than something that's been added by the developers. And diegesis is inevitable in virtual reality. Instead of using controllers to dictate certain actions, in virtual reality, you're actually controlling a person's head and hands. So any mechanics that work well with these controls is going to be naturally diegetic. Shooting and reloading your gun, covering your mouth while passing through poison clouds, or puzzles having to be manipulated with both of your hands. This is how you communicate and interact with the world itself at all times. But one thing that is harder to do in virtual reality is the heads-up display. Heads-up display is a user interface element that displays the most vital information that the player needs to know, be it your health, your ammo count, or a map. And in VR, having a HUD is disgusting, but Alyx places all and any information needed in combat or exploration directly on Alyx's hands. Yeah, the core way that we have been interacting with the game's world has now become our very own personal diegetic HUD that shows you your current health, ammo count, and even crafting resources only visible when you need it. This is just incredible. But wait, there's also multiple different ways to access this same information, like ammo counts being seen diegetically on the side of each weapon, or haptic feedback or subtle vibrations in your controller when you run out of ammo, or a minute heartbeat when your health is getting low. All of this genius HUD and haptic design communicates all of the information you need diegetically and silently, allowing for you to fully focus on gameplay. But it's not perfect. The wrist-mounted item storage and weapon selection are not diegetic and inconsistent with the game's internal logic that's been so consistent everywhere else in the game, which makes these stand out as unrealistic and immersion-breaking. But virtual reality is an incredibly young industry, and as usual, Valve have come such leaps and bounds ahead of anything else that has been released. But on the whole, Alyx does a great job at contextualizing its mechanics and making them feel so natural, which gives the player a lot of space to experiment with them. In most VR games, you're either stuck in place or limited to a single room. But this is one of the most open and freeing virtual reality games I have ever played. Here, you're climbing over rafters, over and under pipes to sneak into hidden rooms, and because of this twisting and adventurous navigation, you have to pay attention to your environment. Making sure the player knows where they're going and what they are doing is essential to maintaining spatial immersion. Getting lost is frustrating, especially in VR. If it gets to the point where the player has to take their headset off to look up where to go, nothing takes you mentally out of a space than actually taking you out of that space. But one of the ways that Alyx counters this is with its genius inclusion of this headset. This is used primarily to talk to Russell. In sections where the player might be headed in an unintuitive direction, Alyx will talk to Russell about it, and he will clear up the reasons why, meaning the player still understands their goals and makes sure they are always on the same page as Alyx. But even if the player knows why they should be going in a certain direction, they still need to know how to navigate the game's levels naturally. It's really important that the player doesn't get lost. Alyx guides the player through its levels using non-intrusive design elements like the placement of certain objects, subtly coloured pipes and diegetic lighting to guide your eyes in certain directions, or collectible items always having a blue glow to draw you in, and interactable items always being coloured red. And this is all communicated silently through colour and lighting to guide you without the player being fully aware of it. So you always know where you are, where you're headed, and why you are going there. But there's still just one small problem. Shooting in VR isn't fun. Aiming down sight manually is awkward, and reloading takes multiple steps, which can be hard to memorize under pressure, and crouching behind cover is just uncomfortable. VR shooters can't ever be as fast-paced or fluid like a game like Call of Duty, but the genius of Alyx's design is that they not only know this, but embrace it to give the player a completely unique kind of experience. Instead, they're trying to mimic a real-life experience of being in a gunfight. They want to put you and Alyx in the same boat. Something so easy in a conventional first-person shooter like aiming and reloading have been made monumental challenges in virtual reality, because this gunplay isn't designed to be fun per se, it's designed to create interesting ludic experiences. There's a trope in action films where the protagonist is fumbling around reloading their gun where they fire just in time before the enemy reaches them, and this happens completely naturally all the time in Alyx. This is influenced with a combination of the intentionally awkward and time-consuming gun reloading mechanics and the design of the enemies themselves, who are constantly pressing forward. These moments were some of the most tense and memorable I have ever had in any game, and it comes down to Alyx embracing the awkwardness of VR gun design to enable interesting ludonarratives. But Alyx also has systems in place designed to create manufactured ludonarratives. I introduced this in the Anatomy of Bloodborne episode. play the clip editing, Jimmy.
It's a sequence of scripted events that will make the player feel that they had an authentic experience that was unique to them, but in fact it was all handcrafted by the developers.
Cheers, mate. Here's a question for all of the people who have played Alyx. Have you ever missed a grenade throw? I very rarely threw one too hard or not hard enough. It always seemed to go where I wanted it to. Well, is this because I'm a badass? Yes, but also no. The game is actually subtly guiding the grenade in the right direction, making the player feel like they've properly thrown the grenade in the right way just to kill the enemies, but this is actually being completely manipulated by the developers. So we've just seen how embracing the limitations of VR design instead of trying to emulate other traditional experiences has allowed Alyx to be a very different but enjoyable kind of experience, one that manages to truly immerse the player in its world. But the question is, where do we go from here? After the virtual reality glass ceiling that Valve just smashed through with this game, what design aspects could take it to the next level? Well, for me, the one and only thing that needs to or could be improved is locomotion, or how you move around the world. I believe this is still the one thing that is holding virtual reality behind. You either just throw your shoes teleporting from place to place, which you've seen in this video can look and feel incredibly janky and breaks immersion, or you move around with the analog stick, which in my personal experience makes me feel motion sick. There has to be a unique and affordable way around locomotion, and if anyone can figure it out, it's you, I mean Valve. But what do you guys think is holding virtual reality design behind, and what would you suggest for a fix for that? All things considered, this is the best virtual reality experience on the market, and one of the best games I have ever played, period. So good job, Valve, and keep pushing the industry forward. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I really hope you enjoyed this episode. And what do you want to see on the next Anatomy episode? Let me know in the comments. If you do really enjoy this series, please consider joining this wonderful team of people on YouTube members and Patreon. Thank you so much for the support, mate. I'll see you in the next one.